You're listening to The Life of Jesus Christ in a Year, from the visions of Anne Catherine Emmerich from TAN. I'm Father Edward Looney, and each day I will be reading and offering commentary to guide you through Anne Catherine Emmerich's magnificent mystical revelations. In addition to listening, you can follow along with the four-volume hardcover set of The Life of Jesus Christ and Biblical Revelations available from TAN. Before we get to today's reading, though, let us ask the intercession of our venerable author. O blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, devout and pious follower of Christ, who patiently endured the frailty of this mortal condition, who humbly received the honorable marks of Christ Jesus on your hands, feet, side, head, and chest, the marks which you were blessed by the Lord to witness for yourself in his own sufferings, we graciously ask for your intercession with God, that we sinners may be forgiven of our sins and be drawn more completely into spiritual communion with Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We ask this in the name of the most holy Lamb of God and through the intercession of Holy Mary, our Mother. Amen. Today is day number 74, and in this episode, we will continue reading from Volume 1, from the section pertaining to the preaching of John the Baptist. Today, we will pick up where we left off in section number 15. The Sanhedrin in Jerusalem again held a long consultation on the subject of Jesus. Everywhere they had spies bribed to give them information of his words and actions. The Sanhedrin consisted of 71 priests and doctors, of whom 20 were again divided into fives, thus forming so many subcommittees for deliberating and disputing together. They examined the genealogical register and could in no way deny that Joseph and Mary were of the house of David and Mary's mother of the race of Aaron. But as they said, these families had fallen into obscurity, and Jesus strolled around with vagrants. He also defiled himself with publicans and heathens and sought the favor of slaves. They had heard, they said, of the familiar way in which he had spoken lately to the Sycamites, who were returning home from their work in the region of Bethlehem, and they thought that he must have designs to raise an insurrection with the aid of such hangers-on. Some gave it as their own opinion that he was very likely an illegitimate child, because he had once proclaimed himself the son of a king. Others declared that he must in some way receive secret training from the devil, for he often retired apart and spent the night alone in the wilderness or on the mountains. They knew what they were saying, for they had already inquired into all of this. Among these 20 deliberators were some who knew Jesus and his family very well, who were most favorably inclined toward him, who were indeed his friends in secret. Nevertheless, they did not contradict what was said against him. They kept silence in order to be better able to serve him and his disciples, and to give them information of whatever might come to their knowledge. The majority of the committee concluded at last that Jesus was in communication with the devil, from whom he received instruction, and this was the opinion they publicly proclaimed, and which was spread throughout Jerusalem. John's disciples announced to him the baptism that had lately taken place in Gilgal, representing the same as a usurpation of his rights. But in deepest humility, John again repeated what he had often told them before, vis-a-vis that he would soon give place to his Lord, whose herald and precursor he had been. The disciples could not rightly understand his words. With about 20 followers, Jesus left Gilgal and moved on to the Jordan, which he crossed on a raft. All around on the beams of the raft were seats, and in the center two concave spaces in which they were accustomed to stand, the camels, that they might not slip between the beams into the water. Three camels could be so accommodated, but now there were none on board, the Lord and his disciples being the only passengers. It was night, and lighted torches stood in the hollow spaces. Jesus related the parable of the sower, which on the following day he explained. The passage over the river occupied 15 minutes at least, for the current at this point was very strong. They had to row some distance up the river and then drift down to the spot at which they intended to land, and which was not directly opposite their standing point. The Jordan is a singular river. It cannot be crossed at all in many places, and its steep shores are pathless. It makes frequent and sudden bends and often appears to flow straight past a place around which it is, in reality, running. Its bed, in many places, is rocky, and its course consequently arrested. Its waters encircle numerous islands as they flow sometimes troubled, sometimes clear, according to the nature of its bed, here and there forming falls. The water of the Jordan is soft and tepid. They landed near the settlement of the publicans, a high road from the region of Kedar passed nearby, and there too a lovely valley took its rise. The publicans, who had already received John's baptism, entertained Jesus, but several of his followers, surprised at their master's intimacy with these despised people, stood shyly aloof. Jesus and his disciples spent the night here, accepting hospitality from one of the publicans, who were most deferential to them. Their houses stood on the side of the road that ran through the valley and not far from the Jordan. Somewhat further on was the inn for the accommodation of merchants and their camels. There were many tarrying here at that time on account of the next day's feast, that of Tabernacles. For although most of them were pagans, yet they were obliged to observe the festivals as days of rest. The publicans questioned Jesus as to how they should restore their unjustly acquired goods. He told them that they should be taken to the temple, which, however, he meant only spiritually, for in reality, he designated thereby his own community, the church. There should, he said, be purchased with it a field near Jerusalem for the support of poor widows. And he explained to them why a field, illustrating by the parable of the sower. Next day, Jesus walked with them on the shore, and in the country around, teaching again of the sower and the future harvest. He took his text from the Feast of Tabernacles, which was then beginning, and which commemorated the vintage, as well as the ingathering of the fruits of the field. From the publican village, Jesus pressed on further through the valley. On either side of the mountain slope, for the distance of half an hour perhaps, were rows of houses in which the Feast of Tabernacles was being celebrated. These houses extended as far as Dibon, in the environs, of which indeed they appeared to be. By their side were erected the booths formed of green branches of trees and adorned with bushes, festoons, and clusters of grapes. On one side of the road were the tabernacles and the little tents of the women, on the other the huts in which the animals were slaughtered. All the food was carried across the road. The children adorned with garlands went in bands from one tabernacle to another, singing and playing upon musical instruments. These last consisted of triangles furnished with rings, which they tinkled, triangles spanned by cords, and a wind instrument from which arose spiral tubes. Jesus paused here and there to teach. Refreshments were offered to him and his disciples, grapes on sticks, two clusters on each. At the further end of this row of houses stood an inn which Jesus entered. Not far from the inn, between it and Dibon, was a broad, open space in the middle of the road. Here, surrounded by trees, arose the large and beautiful synagogue of Dibon. On the next day, Jesus taught in the synagogue, taking again the parable of the sower, alluding to the baptism and the nearness of the kingdom of God. He spoke also of the Feast of Tabernacles and of its celebration here, taking occasion to reprove the people for mixing up heathenish customs in their services, for some of the Moabites still dwelt in this place. And with them, the Jewish people had intimate relations. When Jesus left the synagogue, he found in the open court numbers of sick who had been borne thither on litters. They cried out as soon as they saw him, "Lord, thou hast been sent from God. Thou canst help us. Help us, Lord." He cured many. That evening, a banquet was prepared in the inn for Jesus and his followers. There were many of the heathen merchants near Jesus when he spoke of the call of the Gentiles, of the star that had appeared in the lands of the kings, and of their going to visit the child. Jesus left the place that night alone and went to pray on the mountain. He had engaged to meet his disciples the following morning on the road on the other side of Dibon. Dibon was 6 hours distant from Gilgal. It was rich in fountains and meadows, gardens and terraces, for it lay in the valley and up both sides of the mountain. Jesus next went to Socoth, where he arrived toward evening. An innumerable multitude gathered around him, among them many sick. He taught in the synagogue and allowed Saturnin and 4 other disciples to administer baptism. It took place at a spring in a rocky grotto facing westward toward the Jordan, which, however, could not be seen from it as a hill intervened. But the spring was fed from the deep waters of the river. The light fell into the grotto from apertures in the roof. In front of it was an extensive pleasure garden, beautifully laid out with small trees, aromatic shrubs, and well-kept lawns. In it was an ancient memorial stone commemorative of an apparition of Melchizedek to Abraham. Jesus taught here of John's baptism, which he called a baptism of penance, and which would soon be discontinued. In its stead would be received the baptism of the Holy Ghost and the remission of sin. He received from them a kind of general confession of their sins, and then some separately disclosed their predominant passions and transgressions. Many trembled at hearing Jesus accusing them of sins that they thought secret. After the confession, Jesus laid his hands upon them as if giving absolution. They were not immersed when receiving baptism. A large basin of water was placed on Abraham's memorial stone, and over it the neophytes bowed with bared shoulders. The baptizers poured the water thrice from the hollow of their hand over the heads of the baptized, who were very numerous at this place. Abraham had once dwelt at Succoth with his nurse Maraha, and had owned fields in 3 different localities. Even here he began to share with Lot. It was here that Melchizedek first appeared to Abraham in the same way as did the angels. Melchizedek commanded him a 3-fold sacrifice of doves, long-beaked birds, and other animals, promising to come again and offer bread and wine and sacrifice. He told him what was going to happen to Sodom and to Lot, and pointed out to him 7 graces for which he should pray. Melchizedek at that time had no longer an earthly abode at Salem. Jacob also dwelt at Succoth. From Succoth, Jesus proceeded to Great Chorazin, where, at inn near the city, he had appointed to meet his mother and the holy women. On the way thither, he passed through Gersus, where he kept the Sabbath, after which he went to an inn in the desert some hours from the Sea of Galilee. The proprietors dwelt nearby. The inn was still adorned as for the Feast of Tabernacles, for the holy women had rented it some days previously and put all things in order. The necessary provisions were brought at their expense from Gerasa. Peter's wife was with them, also Susanna of Jerusalem, and all the others, excepting Veronica. Jesus had an interview with his mother alone. He told her that he was now on his way to Bethania, whence he would retire to the desert. Mary was grave and anxious. She begged him not to go to Jerusalem for a while, for she had heard of the council convened on his account. Later on, Jesus gave an instruction. The place chosen for it was a hill, upon which was a stone seat formerly used for the same purpose. There were rows of people from the surrounding country, and about 30 women present. They stood apart from the men. After the instruction, Jesus told his followers that he must now leave them for a time, and that they, as well as the women, should disband until his return. He spoke of John's baptism soon to cease, and of the bitter persecution awaiting him and his. Jesus left the inn with about 20 disciples and followers and journeyed some 12 hours southwest toward the city of Aruma, near which an inn for him and his friends was always in readiness. Martha, for whom the journey to Gerasa was her first expedition with the holy women, had prepared this inn for Jesus and his friends in Jerusalem and bore the cost. The steward and servants lived in the neighborhood. The holy women told Jesus of the inn before his departure. The city was about 9 hours from Jerusalem, and between 6 and 7 from Jericho. This brings us to the end of our reading today, and now we reflect over what we have just read, what we have just listened to. In our opening reading of today, there was this talk about those in the Sanhedrin and how they were divided into factions. And then we heard among these 20 deliberators were some who knew Jesus and his family very well, who were most favorably inclined toward him, who were indeed his friends in secret. Nevertheless, they did not contradict what was said against him. Are they truly friends of the Lord? I think they are friends, yes, associates. They do things, they listen. But they weren't willing to defend Jesus. They didn't want to bring ridicule upon themselves. You could probably think about this in terms of your own friendships. Do you defend people when they're being talked badly about by others? Do you add on to it? We're all guilty of doing those things at times, unfortunately. But maybe as we hear about these friends of the Lord or not so good friends, a good moment for us just to examine our own friendships and how we treat them. We also heard about an apparition of Melchizedek to Abraham. So, of course, living in the age of the church that we live in today, we obviously have been graced with apparitions of Jesus to St. Margaret Mary and St. Faustina and others. We've been graced with apparitions of Mary to visionaries. But we know that Jesus at the Transfiguration, he receives an apparition of Moses and Elijah. And so I guess what I want to point out here is this notion of apparitions isn't so far stretch. That it's happening, Melchizedek to Abraham, for example. And so helps us maybe just to make more sense of the apparitions that we're familiar with, to know that there's a long history, at least according to Anne Catherine Emmerich. This is a startling line here. Many trembled at hearing Jesus accusing them of sins they thought secret. This is the great reminder. We can't hide anything from the Lord. Whatever we have done, the Lord knows it. Whatever we have done, he died to forgive. And so we don't need to hide whatever secret sin of our life. Maybe that secret sin, it's secret from my friends, it's secret from my family, it's secret from others. But you don't need to hide it from Jesus. After the confession, Jesus laid his hands upon them as if giving absolution. But just don't hide, but rather make known to the Lord. If there is some sort of sin, go to confession right away. Experience the freedom that confession offers you. And then he told him what was going to happen to Sodom and to Lot and pointed out to him several graces for which he should pray. Several graces for which he should pray. We can pray for special graces, for certain graces. You know, maybe we read certain writings of holy men and women, saints or whoever. And maybe as we're reading that, there are graces that become known to us that we should pray for. Allow whatever your experience of the spiritual life is to lead you into what you should pray for. Special graces that you're praying for. Well, to pray for patience or perseverance. To pray for joy. Whatever it is. Maybe today, name a special grace and begin praying for it. Well, this brings us to the close of today's reading. I hope that you'll join us again tomorrow as we continue making our way through the life of Jesus Christ and biblical revelation. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast and sign up for email notifications at emmerichpodcast.com and use coupon code ACE25 for 25% off your next order at tanbooks.com. And if you don't mind, please share this podcast with others, share it on social media, email it to your prayer group, text a link to your friends. Let them know you're listening and encourage them to, so you can have holy conversations about what we're hearing and reading from Anne Catherine Emmerich. Until next time, may God bless you and Mary pray for you.